gentlemen, boys and girls, it's time once again for The Johnny Mandolin Show, broadcasting live from New York City. Tonight I've got two great guests in studio. I've got Florida Al Carbolosa and singer Eric DeLauro, and we are going to take a look at and chat about some of our favorite movies and more. As always, a great time on The Johnny Mandolin Show, so don't touch that mouse. We're broadcasting live right here. Johnny Mandolin here, our theme song, Anello's Blues, bringing us to another fun Johnny Mandolin show. We're broadcasting on City World Radio and simulcasting on Italian American Radio and having a good time. I want to remind you we're brought to you by Sexton Records, that's C-E-X-T-O-N Records, Sexton with a C, Sexton.com. Great big band jazz, small band jazz, singers, and Italian American music. Check it out. So to the mic tonight, I want to bring my very good friend from Florida, Al Carbolosa.
Johnny, how's it going, man?
Great. And great my to also see you. My very good friend from Hoboken, Eric DeLauro.
Buonasera, Johnny.
Buonasera. Come stai? So, yeah. So, you know, we're always having fun in New York. New York is always an adventure for us. We actually explore and boldly go where we haven't gone before and see fun things in New York. Great restaurants, great dive bars. And formerly, we did a whole show on dive bars in New York.
It was a great show. That was a lot of fun.
Yeah, we got a lot of listeners.
And I went back to every single one of those bars.
And a lot of people, you know, who listened said, hey, you guys, I'm going to New York next month, and I'm going to go find those bars. So
yeah,
that
was
great.
Great.
And maybe we'll throw some in today, too. But Al and I were talking the other day. We were having a nice conversation, and we were talking about movies, all kinds of movies, from silent films to something brand new. And we said, you know, we got to talk more about that and talk about share some of our favorite things with the fans. And we're going to do that tonight. And I wanted to just kick it off by saying that I still think to this day my favorite film is Casablanca.
Oh, yeah.
Humphrey Bogart.
Yeah.
And all the great actors in there. And the fact that movie was so phenomenal, and they didn't know the ending. they wrote the ending as it went, right?
Making it up as they went along, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And we were also saying that if you wanted to quote lines, you know, movies with the most quotable lines, I mean, it's hard to beat that movie.
Yeah,
really.
It really is. Yeah. It was just amazing. And some of the lines in it, some of the acting in it, and you know, at the time when it was done, it was timely, you know?
Yeah.
And yeah, that movie, man.
I was just watching, you know, we just happened to be talking about that, and the other night I was just watching TV, and there was a little documentary that was on TV that I just happened to see, and they were talking about a couple of filmmakers, and it was Cameron Crowe, it was Martin Scorsese, it was can't remember who else, but anyway, in the documentary, they were trying to come up with their favorite scene, and it was unbelievable. Their favorite scene was mine, and that was when the Germans were in the cafe, and they were singing this German patriotic song, and Victor Laszlo goes up to the band, and he says, play La Marseillaise, you know, plays the French anthem, and they started playing it, and then you saw the facial reactions, you saw the different people at the bar and the tears coming down, you saw the face of Ingrid Bergman as she looks at Victor Laszlo with, you know, the adoration, and I just remember that scene just gave me chills, you know.
Yeah, that was one of the great ones.
Yeah.
That was really one of the good ones. Yeah. I always loved when they went up to Claude Renault, and he says, "I'm shocked. There's gambling going on." Yeah. And they go, "Here's your winnings."
Yeah.
You remember that? that was always a great scene. Do you have Eric? You got a favorite scene out of that?
Well, I'll tell you, I do love the movie. It's a lot of fun, and the cinematography is spectacular.
Oh, yeah. God, oh yes. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Oh, the scene at the end with the fog, the way they shot that, you know, it was just gorgeous, beautiful. And then there was they're walking away at the end of the movie, and him and Claude Rains, Renault. What was his rank?
Lieutenant Renault.
I can't remember. Captain Renault. So they're walking away, and the camera pans back. Do you remember? Or are they? You know, you just see them walking forward, and the camera's panning back. And it's Louis, this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
Yeah.
It was great.
And they actually used a little model plane to make it look in the distance.
Oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know that. Yeah, that's cool. That's cool.
It really was. It really was a great movie.
Well, okay, so let me ask you then, Johnny. So you mentioned, is that your favorite line in the movie?
It's not necessarily my favorite, but it's one of the most memorable, you know?
So what would, like if you had to say, just quote your favorite.
It's so hard to say. I mean, I love when he says, everybody in Casablanca has problems. Oh. Maybe yours will work out.
That's good. That's a good one. That's a good one.
I mean, there's just so many of them that what's the line about he's like any other man, but more so or something.
Oh, yeah. The young woman who Captain Renault is going to have come to her office the next morning, but he's planning some room. He wants to kind of get her, you know, and she knows that that's what's going to happen, but she wants to, you know, win passage for her and her husband. So she says, she's just so desperate. And she says to Rick, she says, "Rick, what kind of a man is Captain Renault?" And he says, "He's like any other man, only more so."
Yeah. I know. He was definitely being dodgy there. But the whole movie, I mean, and it's interesting, too, if you ever compare Humphrey Bogart's character when they're in France, and he's just so happy and in love, and then he's in Casablanca, he's scowling and kind of depressed and brokenhearted, you know.
Well, but then, see, this is the sign of a great movie. There's the arc of the character.
Yeah, yeah.
So right, so he's cynical and he's lost all of his idealism, but then he once had it when he was with Ingrid Bergman. He loses it. Now she comes back and he regains it, and at the end, when he says he puts her on the plane, he regains his idealism.
Yeah,
yeah. The arc of a great, great character. Yeah.
No, everything about that movie I like, and I actually have it on DVD, and I have some kind of remastered director's cut with outtakes of Humphrey Bogart.
Mm. Those are pretty.
Oh wow!
Oh, yeah.
Oh wow!
Those are nice.
Yeah. Where do you ever see that? But definitely that's on my top list, and jump in here with whatever favorite movie you guys have. Godfather is certainly up on the top of the list there, you know?
Certainly. You know, I hate to be a dissenting opinion for all this great artistry, but, you know, from Hoboken, we actually got that great On the Waterfront, the great Ilya Kazan classic, right?
Absolutely. Get no argument from me on that.
And, you know, I'm almost a film documentary film fan. And for us in Hoboken, it is very much a documentary film. You know, some people thought it was a story.
Mm-hmm.
But for us, it was just everyday reality of going to work.
Absolutely.
And, Ilya Kazan. My family were longshoremen, and, you know, certainly saw just about every ounce of that. And for us in Hoboken, you know, some people thought it was a crime drama. We thought it was just a Disney film.
Right, right.
Another day on the waterfront.
Right. And all the all the guys from the Method Actor School, of them, Lee J. Cobb and Carl Malden.
Potato Eater.
Yeah.
Carl Malden.
Yeah.
You got a lot of...
Just a great film. Again, great cinematography.
Eric, let me ask you this. Would you rate that as Marlon Brando's greatest, most quintessential performance?
Tough to say, but it certainly was pretty interesting. And, he had such a large body of work. But when it gets down to it, it was very interesting for us because it was just, a little slice of life, of our lives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That we walked by every single day.
Yeah.
Hoboken, kind of a square bordered city, and mm-hmm. and the largest part of that square rectangle is the waterfront.
Sure. Right.
So it's say it's a mile square, but we had docks from one side, one end of the town all the way to the other end.
Right.
And it's quite hard to believe that we had during World War II.
Mm-hmm.
There are many aerial photos where we had over 100 ships tied to the Hoboken docks.
Wow.
Today we have one dock left, and it's a ferry or repair facility, mm-hmm. soon to be a refueling station.
Wow.
One left. They all, each and every dock, mysteriously
disappeared.
Had a small little fire.
In New York City, the west side of New York City was full of shipping and docks. Mm-hmm. And no more. Now it's
the West Village.
Yeah, it's all pleasure stuff now. Yeah. But the docks back in the day were not somewhere you'd hang out.
Right.
Now everybody's down, on the pier, and they have tango dancing, and they're sipping mint with juleps.
Showing a movie.
Yeah, but back then you didn't go down there unless you either had nefarious deeds you wanted to commit, or
and you had a union card.
Yeah, and or you carried a gun,
So it's just a spring off of that then, Ilya Kazan. So I would he's definitely one of my favorite directors. Do you ever see a movie called Face in the Crowd? Andy Griffith, you remember that movie, Face in the Crowd? Andy Griffith.
I think I
do. Where
he
plays Lonesome Rhodes. It's very, very. It's he's a populist politician.
Yes.
And
incredible role.
Yeah.
For Andy Griffith.
Unbelievable. The performance that he does. And I remember I was a kid growing up, and I grew up watching the Andy Griffith Show. So I think of him as
Andy of Mayberry.
Andy of Mayberry. That's the way. And then
it shows his range. He was quite incredible.
Oh my God, he was unbelievable in that.
He was quite incredible.
Yeah. Unbelievable.
Great actor. And that whole era of filmmaking, that classic filmmaking, when a movie came out back then, because it wasn't like, well, I'm gonna watch Amazon or Netflix, or I'm gonna watch TV, or you went to a movie because that was it. I mean, that was the thing.
Yeah.
It was a really big deal, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, and the whole film noir. Ilya Kazan wasn't exactly in that. But he kind of was, you know, and it was all the black and white, gritty street feel, very mm-hmm. realistic, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was always a big film noir fan and loved all the Bogart ones, the Maltese Falcon.
Yes,
Key Largo and all of those,
mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
as well as others that, The Postman Always Rings Twice. And
yes.
I'm talking about the first
Dial M for Murder.
Yeah, sure. Those were always cool. And when I was a kid, sometimes that was the only thing on the TV besides, the Test Pattern and a couple of other local programs. So we're dating ourselves. But
there's something about black and white. When a movie's in black and white, it just tells you something right from the get-go.
Mm-hmm.
When like today, if you see a movie that's in black and white, and there are very, very few. But for a while there, I don't know if you remember, like Woody Allen did a couple of black and white films, and this was in the 70s. So there was something about doing a film in black and white. It just changed the whole perspective on it.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And it was for film noir, especially, because it's a dark, grainy kind of image. And, I used to like all those, the Raymond Chandler novels and mm-hmm, all the different things brought into that film noir aspect. And I think more modern day, maybe like movies like, I'm trying to think of an example. Well, like L.A. Confidential. Kim Basinger mm-hmm. and Russell Crowe. Yeah. And that was very good.
And one of our favorites, kind of in that area with Burt Lancaster and Tony Curtis, Sweet Smell of Success.
Yeah.
Great New York movie.
Mm-hmm.
Then that's, you know, that's a fantastic movie.
Yeah, you know, one of the things we like to do is watch old movies shot in New York
mm-hmm.
to see the backgrounds
yeah.
and to see the old.
It is extraordinary.
It really is. And I mean, a lot of times, you know, I saw a movie not too long ago and it was, Ernest Borgnine, Marty.
Marty.
Right.
And Marty, that's another good one.
And the interesting thing about Marty, was shot up near Arthur Avenue.
Yes.
And in that movie, you can see the 3rd Avenue L train mm-hmm. went right up to Arthur Avenue, which they tore down.
Yeah.
Somebody sold them a bill of goods because there was
a subway
right up to Arthur Avenue.
Great movie. And one of the supporting actors in that was, and I don't know his name, from Gomer Pyle, Sergeant Carter. What was that actor's name? Sergeant Carter.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But anyway, he was Marty's pal. And another one was Jerry Paris,
yeah.
who was a writer on the Dick Van Dyke Show.
That's right.
And he was a supporting actor in that movie.
Yeah. Yeah, but it was so funny because talking about backgrounds, you could still see the 3rd Avenue L. And I have this version of Taxi Driver. A great film, you know, Martin Scorsese.
Yeah.
And Robert De Niro. And this was on DVD, mm-hmm. and it came with two DVDs, and one was the movie, and the other was a kind of a documentary about Martin Scorsese talking about how they made the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And he was talking about at one point they were trying to get an overhead camera in this dilapidated brownstone in Upper West Side. Now, you know, the $20 million brownstone. Back mm-hmm. then it was the shell of a building,
yeah.
and they actually cut the brownstone in half, physically cut it in mm-hmm. half to build in the different tracks they needed for the cameras.
Wow.
But anyway, again, on the second DVD, which is a documentary, part of the DVD is a split screen, and they show all the scenes that were shot in Taxi Driver, and then all the same locations in present day.
Oh,
it's
wow.
on a split screen.
Wow.
It really is amazing. You know, you see some rundown garage, and now it's like, you know, a outdoor coffee shop with, you know, a cappuccino.
It is an awful lot of fun to watch movies that way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And pick out all the New York City landmarks.
You know, right.
Our skyline's changing so much
mm-hmm.
that, you know, it keeps it fresh, but it's also fun to try to revisit each and every one of those sites.
Yeah, right. If you grew up in back then, you'll see places you used to go to that aren't there anymore, you know, restaurants or, you know, bars that aren't there anymore.
Probably that scene in Manhattan? It's in Manhattan when Woody Allen is sitting below the 59th Street Bridge at dawn with, would that have been Mia Farrow? Margot Hemingway. And they're sitting there, they're out all night, and they end up like at dawn, and they're sitting on the park bench overlooking the East River, right in the shadow of the 59th Street Bridge. And he's saying, I don't care what anybody else says, but this city is just the greatest. It's just such a knockout. And it's just perfect, perfect.
Yeah, it is. And you know, we have so many listeners from around the country and around the world. And a lot of my friends, I have lots of friends in California, and they haven't been to New York, and they'll talk about, like, mm-hmm. wow, did you, like, actually see that? That was in the movie. Did you actually go there?
Yeah.
Yeah, I passed it yesterday on
that
my
way. That bench is still there.
Yeah, I was. It's like I passed it yesterday on my way down to the village.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
Are still there, and some things aren't.
That's right. A lot is gone.
We had some relatives in town a few months back. It was quite interesting. We're trying to find those movie spots. And we found, you know, it's funny. Sometimes we don't get to see our own city unless relatives come into town, and we're touring around town with them.
Right.
And we found a tour guy who was amazing. James, I think it was Jimmy Dykes from Rich and Famous Tours.
Mm.
It's quite good. And, you know, he's very conversational, knows all the spots, and will give you almost a tour each and every spot, naming the movies that were shot there.
Yeah.
Or do you remember the scene?
Yeah.
So it was really quite good.
Yeah. I used to work on on the Upper East Side at this law firm, and it was actually right near, I think it was 3rd Avenue and 53rd Street, mm-hmm. and I was walking by it one day, and somebody, older gentleman, you know, I forget, we were waiting for the bus or waiting, I forget what we were doing, and somehow we were talking about movies, and he said, "You see that grate?" And I'm looking down, and there's a grate in the sidewalk, and he says, "You know that grate's famous." And I'm thinking, it is. And he goes, "Yeah, that was where Marilyn Monroe stood when the dress blew up."
Oh,
you know,
wow.
That was right there. It was 3rd Avenue and 53rd Street.
7 year itch.
Yep, yep. So you're right. There's a lot of things you know you don't notice.
And that's another great New York movie. Remember, it was a hot summer.
Yeah.
And that was the whole theme of the movie. It was hot, and she liked to sit, you know, put her legs up by the air conditioner, and Tom Ewell.
Yeah. Great movie. But again, that's just another thing where you'd walk right over this grate and not know it.
Yeah.
And that's part of the movie. I think I know, being, you know, from Little Italy and hanging out down in Little Italy, you know, there's a lot like Donnie Brasco, mm-hmm. or The Godfather, where they actually shot the feast scene down on, mm-hmm. the feast, you, mm-hmm. know, on the,
yeah.
San Gennaro feast.
Yeah.
And,
Donnie Brasco is maybe, that's my favorite Johnny Depp movie.
Yeah.
That's my favorite role for Johnny Depp.
He was good.
And I like him in almost everything
he
does.
Yeah, I like Gilbert Grape, and I like
But in that movie, and also, I got to say, that's my favorite role for Al Pacino, because Al Pacino, for once, doesn't play the most powerful guy, you know, in the movie. He plays kind of a weak character. You know, that's his days are ending, really.
Yeah.
But he thinks, he tries to puff himself up.
Yeah.
And
that was a great.
Yeah,
movie.
That was great. I love him in that role.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was super.
Yeah.
Well, a lot of great documentaries out these days. You know, being Italian American, and that we're rebroadcasting on Italian American radio, we have some amazing things. And you know, my movie specialty format is music documentaries. Hmm. Especially these days. A lot of great things. So every time I'm turning around these days, you never know what artists are going to be profiled in a really incredible complimentary documentary that's being delivered. So quite a shock. Just last month, went to the opening night of Ron Howard's documentary on Pavarotti. Hmm. It's incredible. He did a great job.
Heard about it, yeah.
He did an amazing job. What a great homage. Mm-hmm. Long overdue homage to Pavarotti.
Wow.
And, full-length documentary. It didn't cut any corners. I think the toughest part about the documentary films is getting all the, since so many different people shot them, is to get any access to the copyright, mm-hmm. or permissions to be able to use the footage.
Yeah, you have to license everything.
But it's, in light of our upcoming Feast of San Gennaro here in Manhattan.
Coming up.
And, our Italian Cultural Month here in October.
Mm-hmm.
It's a must-see.
Yeah.
And I believe it's to be shortly this fall, to be shortly on DVD.
Wonderful.
But Ron Howard, who knew we could do such a great job on documentaries?
Yeah. Looking forward to that. I'm a big opera fan, too, and my wonderful daughter, Marianella, was a professional opera singer, so any chance I get to, you know, see it or learn more about it, it's always interesting. That's
I'm
really
looking
good
forward
point.
To seeing her. I understand that she's going to be performing.
That's
at
it.
The New York City Feast of San Gennaro. Is that right?
That's 100% right.
What date is that going to be?
It is September 12th, the opening day of the feast. It's at 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on what they call the main stage, which is Grand and Mott, right in the heart of Little Italy. 5 p.m. I'm going to play Johnny Mandolin in concert, and Marie's going to join me, and it's going to be a lot of fun. I've opened it every year for, like, I don't know, the last, I can't even count how many years, but but thank you for mentioning that, because it's going to be a lot of fun. And getting back to how that got launched, I was saying The Godfather, they shot the feast at the feast. And one of our friends who works, we hang out at this, Al and I hang out a lot at this great Italian bar and restaurant called Arturo's, which we've mentioned many times on the show. And our good friend Jane was in that movie. She was one of the communion girls walking up the street, because at the time they shot it, she was about 7 or 8 years old, and she's in the movie.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of a funny thing. But New York is a movie set. I mean, it truly is. You can walk down almost any street and just look around and go, "This should be a movie," you know. Mm-hmm. whether it's, you know, from Chinatown up to Inwood, there's always something that's great. And beyond that, I have to say Newark, Hoboken, Jersey City, there's a lot of really great places. And, of course, you would know, Eric, you'd know Hoboken best. Some iconic things, brownstones, old buildings, factories, things like
that. Certainly. And in Hoboken, since it hasn't changed that much, there are some of the many locations for on the waterfront are still there. Scenes where they're talking the park, the churches are still being used. A lot of different things. And it was shot mostly on location, I think about half on location and half on movie sets.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Yeah, I was interested to find out that the movie, it was actually Scorsese's first feature film.
Mean Streets
was shot, the exteriors were shot in Little Italy, like St. Patrick's Hall Cathedral, but a lot of the interiors were shot in Los Angeles on a soundstage.
Yeah.
That movie magic, right?
You have to be. I guess that's the economics of what you have to do.
Yeah, and the sound on-site control.
On-site location has to be very expensive.
Right? Yeah, it is. And of course, you can't control the fire truck riding by, you know, when you're there. But,
you know, another just popped into my head is Pope of Greenwich Village.
Oh yeah, another great film.
Great, and a lot of those scenes, you know, the bars that we've all been in, you know, right there off of West Fourth.
West Fourth.
Yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
As a super film, and a little bit ahead of its time too there, but that was just an amazing film. And there's so many little things that I'm sure Eric, being Italian American like myself, and Al being a big fan of it, you pick up on little indications, like when Daryl Hannah says, "Oh, I'll cook you dinner." He goes, "No, that's okay. Don't do me any favors." No, don't make the food. I'll make the food, because Italian men are usually in the kitchen cooking, you know, so myself included. And I thought just little things you pick up on that are funny.
Yeah.
But anyway, well, you listen to the Johnny Mandolin Show. We're at our halfway point here in the show. We're going to be right back. I'm with Eric DeLauro from Hoboken, unbelievably great singer. We're going to talk more about him. And my wonderful friend, Florida Al Carbolosa, who's up from Florida, who's also a New Yorker, because he not only lives in Florida, but he lives in New York. And you're listening to the Johnny Mandolin Show on City World Radio and on Italian American Radio. And we're going to be right back. Evening in Roma. Hey, that's from my new album. It's called, the album's called Tonight, Songs Evening in Roma, Johnny Mandolin on Sexton Records, our sponsor. So we were talking on the break more about movies, of course, and locations, and also how New York kind of dictates sometimes the whole feel of the movie, at least, and just as a Western would be dictated by, you know, a desert scene or a Western prairie. And you were hit. We're talking about the Empire State Building, and
yeah, the An Affair to Remember, Rock Hudson, and I just cannot remember the female lead, but she's a wonderful actress, and they make a date to meet at a certain at 5 p.m. I think it is on a Friday on the top of the Empire State Building, and she's all excited, and she's on her way there, and she has a terrible car accident. She gets out of a car, she gets hit by a car, and she becomes a paraplegic. And so he's up there waiting for her, and he's thinking he got stood up. And so he becomes very bitter, and he starts to really hate her. And I don't want to give away if anybody wants to see that movie, but just a beautiful, beautiful, poignant movie.
Yeah, and of course the Empire State is so iconic in
it
that.
It becomes the whole
central
point. And
I mean, that's been a feature in many movies. Look at King Kong.
King Kong, another one. Yeah, the Empire State Building.
Yeah,
yeah.
Where would King Kong be without that climb? You know, he can't climb a McDonald's or something.
Yeah,
that.
Yeah.
So that's really...
So if John Ford filmed all of his Westerns in that one, you know, Monument Valley area, of, then who would be the chronicler of New York urban landscape? I would have to say it'd probably be Scorsese, right?
Scorsese a couple of different guys did a lot of... I'm trying to think. Who did Dressed to Kill? De Palma?
Oh, Brian De Palma. Brian De Palma. Yeah, Brian De Palma.
And
yeah.
And then...
Woody Allen.
Yeah, Woody Allen,
Woody
of
Allen.
Course.
That's what he's known for.
Yeah, yeah.
New York movies.
Yeah, and there's a couple others I was thinking of, too. But oftentimes, especially in the movies of the 70s, when the whole thought was how bad New York was, like
right.
Death Wish,
mm-hmm.
Charles Bronson, you know?
They were thrilled. At the time in the 70s, New York was offering a very high tax credit to help incentivize a lot of movie production here. And good for them. Smart move.
Yeah.
They
uh-huh.
did it. And
yeah.
it made it extra nice. And it carried forward in the 80s. We still see some amazing movies. I mean, mm-hmm. everyone wants to see The Firehouse from Ghostbusters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
You know, or
that's another one. That's another one, yeah.
Yeah, our engineer Preston is here. Was that what you were going to say?
I was going to mention Warriors.
Oh, Warriors, yeah,
oh,
of course.
Yeah, yeah,
all
yeah.
all shot in the subways and around the Queens and Brooklyn. And
that's right.
A lot of movies. Bad Lieutenant. There's a movie called U-Turn, which is a real dark film shot in Brooklyn. And I'm trying to think of some of the other ones just right offhand that, well, you know... what was the one, You've Got Mail or something with Tom Hanks? Where
yeah.
She, yes,
yeah.
That
yeah.
was that's a more contemporary film, also shot on the Upper West Side, I
yeah.
think.
Yeah, yeah.
But, yeah, it's just, yeah. You know, not only is the whole place a movie set on the positive side, but sometimes on the negative side, the whole place is a movie set.
Yeah.
So if you try to park your car or walk down the street and some production assistant's going, no, you can't walk. What do you mean I can't walk? I'm going to the subway. What are you doing? No, we're shooting the, just wait a minute, we're shooting the scene here.
Yeah, yeah.
What do you want to be, an extra?
So. But I got to admit, whenever I see that, I hang around a little bit, see if I can spot a face that I know or something like that. I mean, for me, it's exciting, you know.
Yeah, one of the nicest people I've ever run into in that exact setting was I was coming out of the 6 train, for those New Yorkers or those who've been in New York, coming out of the 6 train on Spring Street, walking east towards Mulberry Street to go to Little Italy, and I run right into the middle of a movie set, and who's there but Andie MacDowell. And
oh,
she's
wow.
gorgeous. She's just a really, really beautiful woman. And you remember her from Groundhog
Absolutely.
Day?
Yeah,
so
yeah, sure.
Movies,
yeah. And so I come out of the subway, and what actually happened was they were filming right around the exit, you know, the entrance to the subway, exit of the subway. Mm-hmm. So I literally walked into the movie. I mean, physically, she's doing her lines, they're doing it, the camera's rolling, and I come out of the subway, you know, we've got my little bag and my little fedora hat on. I think the mandolin was slung over my back. And I get up and I'm walking and I look up and I'm as close as I am to you guys, which is across the table, Andie MacDowell. I kind of went, and I hear the director go, cut. And I go, oh my God, I'm so sorry. And she's like, no, don't worry about it. It's okay. You know, we should have blocked that entrance off or something. And I said, you're Andy McDowell. She goes, yeah, I am. She says, it's nice to meet you. She shook my hand.
Yeah.
She took a picture with me. It was like, I was just like, oh my God, you know, because a lot of times I'm like, get out of my face. How dare you look at me? I'm famous. Don't look at me, you know. So
yeah.
She was a doll. So, Andy, if you're listening, thank you.
What about that time that you and I went to, me and my friend Dan, we went to the Tribeca Film Festival and we saw a replay of King of Comedy?
Yeah. This was the King of Comedy is one of the best. I think
a great New York movie also, yeah.
Robert De Niro, Jerry Lewis movies.
Yeah, Jerry Lewis.
And the cool thing, you want to say what happened
afterwards? Well, it was funny because we're there, and I had just gotten this new phone, and I didn't really know how to work the phone that well. So we're in the theater, and we're like in the first six rows. Because it's one of my all time favorite movies. If you know, not it's in the top five. So, out walks Marty Scorsese and Robert De Niro at the end of the movie, and they're taking questions, and they're talking this and that, and then who comes out but Jerry Lewis, and he's still alive.
Not anymore. I don't think, is he?
What?
No more? No, he just recently passed.
Oh, did he? I didn't even hear that. Okay, so anyway,
he's always present.
Yeah,
that's right. And anyway, so I went to take a picture, and. And I didn't know that the flash was not disabled, and I snapped it, and it just, the flash, and it was in a dark movie, you know, it just lit up. Martin Scorsese looked over at me, and with this look, like I turned into a pillar of salt. I thought I was just going to just die right there, you know. I was like,
yeah, and it was fun because after the movie, there was a Q&A with Martin Scorsese and Robert De Niro, and as Al just said, about halfway through, Jerry Lewis walks in and did a comedy routine as he walked in.
Puts
puts
the glass in his mouth, you know, puts the clown nose on.
Yeah.
He was great.
Yeah. It was a really interesting one of a kind type show.
Yeah.
And I had met him before in Las Vegas about 25, 30 years ago. There was a really great jazz drummer in L.A. who's no longer with us. And I signed him to Sexton Records, and it was the first... one of the first jazz albums I ever produced. It would have been 1984 or 5. His name was Chiz Harris. But Chiz was the drummer, besides being a great L.A. jazz drummer and recording artist, he was the drummer for all the Jerry Lewis telethons. So I was actually in Vegas, and he invited me to go see the show live. And afterwards, we went back and went to Jerry Lewis's dressing room, which was unbelievable. It was at Caesars, I think, and it was huge. It was like a floor, and there was a huge banquet table and a full bar and, you know, all kinds of food and a lot of people, you know, wandering around. And so Chiz introduces us to Jerry Lewis, and he shakes our hand, nice to meet you. And then he says, you guys look hungry, eat something. And it's, you know, there's you know, prime rib and salads and sandwiches. Full bar, but that was something I remember.
Wow, that's cool.
That was fun. Yeah. And so let's talk a little more contemporary now, in terms of some of the new directors and what's going on. And
well, I'll tell you, I'd like to talk briefly about two great music documentaries, which are a lot of fun, especially since we have three musicians in a room. The first is an incredible, you know, being from Hoboken and being a fan of Sinatra Rat Pack music. And, you know, it's special to me in my heart because, you know, it's one of these Hoboken things where my grandparents lived and grew up in the very same building with Frank, same house he was born in there many years ago. So we love the traditions and things. But I'd like to talk about a documentary for his friend, Mr. Sammy Davis, who's long overdue to get his due and to be recognized. And it's really incredible. It's recently out, documentary film of about 2 hours. There's a good friend in there who's a historian and very extraordinary music jazz writer and critic, Will Freewald. Does a couple scenes in there, but it's Sammy Davis, I've Gotta Be Me. Recently, the director was Sam Pollard. But I think the the credit really goes to his editor, who said he moved 25 hours of film down to just an hour and 50 minutes.
Amazing.
So that's a great one. And the second one, which is about the Los Angeles recording scene in the 60s and 70s, which is a lot of fun, is a film called The Wrecking Crew.
Yeah, I just recommended that to someone.
And it profiles so many great Los Angeles-based musicians who came together and performed the backing tracks, the instrumentals for some of the greatest songs we all know by the Beach Boys,
Mamas and the
Monkees, the Mamas
everybody.
And the Papas.
Yeah.
I think one of the funniest ones was, we have the image of amazing Los Angeles music being made by this guy who was always seemed to be partying and had a great time, Herb Albert and the Tijuana Brass.
Yeah.
And, you know, for the years, I thought these guys were in Tijuana, these great brass players, drinking tequila. But in fact, it was all the Wrecking Crew.
It was the Wrecking Crew, yeah.
Every single cut.
Well, it's funny because, first of all, see that movie. It's unbelievable. And
now on DVD.
Yeah, now on DVD. And one of the guys who was in the Wrecking Crew, his name was J. Migliori, great tenor sax player, is also on Sexton Records. I produced his album in 1990. He passed away, unfortunately, soon thereafter. But he was one of the mainstays in the Wrecking Crew. And there were so many great musicians who came out of there.
So
Glenn Campbell was in the Wrecking Crew.
Yeah.
You know, he was in the Wrecking Crew.
So many songwriters.
Tommy Tedesco. Carol Kay on bass.
And this started really as a homage by his son, who became the documentary film editor and collector, Denny Tedesco. He wanted to do it. A homage to his father and all of his father's friends. A very nice way to do it, collecting interviews of family friends like Glenn Campbell, like Leon Russell, who was another member of keyboardist, and then so many great songwriters that put together so many of the most memorable songs from the 60s and 70s.
They were a little factory, and they would just knock out great music, great musicians, and a lot of the beginning, like if you listen to the Mamas and the Papas, California Dreamin', and it's got that iconic beginning, ding, 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 ding. And that was actually, I think Tommy Tedesco wrote that beginning, and also some of the bass lines, Carol Kay, woman bass player, wrote some of the iconic bass play, opening bass things that started many of these pop songs, and
Those great instrumentalists, those were putting those hooks in to pull you right into the music,
right.
Was their value add.
Yeah.
I mean, they were not just great instrumentalists, they were arrangers with these great hooks, these great riffs that just pulled you right into the music.
Great composer, and it's
funny, even today when we hear that opening riff, we just know it's going to be a great song that we all love and respect.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it catches your ear right away. And
the documentary profiles a lot of great songwriters as well, great producers of these songs, people that were behind the scenes, telling you about some of the most incredible stories about each and every song or each and every album.
Yeah,
it's quite something.
And as you said, so many, the Monkees. That was all the Wrecking Crew. And a lot of the Beach Boys stuff, they in the studio, that was a lot of the Wrecking Crew. Mm-hmm.
The Archies.
Yeah,
the Archies.
Gary Lewis and the Playboys.
Yeah.
Sonny and Cher.
Yeah, just Google the Wrecking Crew. And luckily,
strongly recommend the director's cut. The latest releases now have extra interviews.
Mm-hmm.
And in the meantime, until you get your own personal copy of it, which is worthy of anybody's library, please check out some of the outtakes, which are incredible interviews available on YouTube, The Wrecking Crew. And, of course, we just lost the most iconic drummer of The Wrecking Crew, Hal Blaine, who was extraordinary.
Yeah, those guys were amazing. And I got to meet several of them because at the time that that was going on, and actually just post, just after that, I was working a lot in Los Angeles in studio. I used to do a lot of movie soundtracks that I'd play on, and I did a lot of the producing for the early Sexton Records jazz recordings out there at several of the studios that we'd work at on Sunset Boulevard. And I got to meet so many of them just in passing. I'd be in Studio A, they'd be in Studio B, you know, and it was really a pleasure to meet them. So thank you for bringing that up. And we were going to talk about some contemporary filmmakers that, you know, of course, the great ones, the Hitchcock and all these other guys that now, you know, David Lynch, and I think I like Quentin Tarantino a lot. I really liked his new movie. He writes alternative endings that turn out happier usually than like Inglourious Bastards or Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. But just great stuff, you know. Yeah. And
you know, this is kind of the year of the musical movie, right? Because you've got Rocket Man, kind of echoing Eric what you said about the Wrecking Crew. There's a documentary, Jacob Dylan produced it, called Echo in the Canyon, and it's about the movie, the music scene in the mid '60s in Laurel Canyon, California. So it would be the Byrds, Mamas and the Papas, the Beach Boys.
I have to see that
Buffalo
one.
Springfield is fantastic. But there's a million more. There's the movies about Freddie Mercury. Then there's Yesterday.
Yeah.
A movie just came out, Blinded by the Light, about Bruce Springsteen. So it's just really the year of the documentary style music movie.
Yeah, it's really true. And it's, you know, music adds so much to a movie. If you watched a movie without any music in it, even like a famous movie, if you removed the music, it wouldn't be the same.
You know, when you just say that, one movie, probably one of my favorite movies of all time, but there was a guy who wrote a commentary about this movie. It was a movie called The Graduate, Dustin Hoffman, you know, from the late 60s.
Of course.
One of my all-time favorite movies. And and the commentary was that the Simon and Garfunkel movie that accompanied that movie kind of turned it into a J.D. Salinger kind of a film, just this coming of age, and it added this poignancy and this artistry to it, that without that music, that movie wouldn't have been as powerful, emotionally hooking as it was.
Sure, look at the great music by Nino Rota in The Godfather, you know? You hear some of that, and it immediately, you just hear those, two measures, and immediately you're right there in the scene.
Yeah.
Was that Angelo Di Pippo?
He was in it, I think. He played in it. Our friend plays accordion, a famous guy, and wonderful musician. But Nino Rota wrote most of that music, and I love playing it, too, because playing mandolin, it lends itself quite naturally to that music, although I think I can play anything on mandolin. I've played, you know, John Sousa marches on mandolin. Mm. They don't sound quite the same, but they're
fine.
Doesn't
have the same impact.
Yeah, they're not as a tuba, but
the horn section.
Yeah, but it's still fun to listen to. But all right. So
John, just while I have my calendar open, one second, I'm going to be able to see Marie Thursday, September 12th.
Yep,
on the main stage. At San Gennaro?
Little Italy, New York City, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, the 12th of September. Hopefully it won't rain and we have electric and we'll be able to do that. You have some gigs coming up that people see?
Certainly. You know, it's Italian Festa season. We always love to see friends come out and visit with us. This upcoming Thursday, August 22nd, we will be at the Feast of San Sebastiano in Montclair, New Jersey, just off the famous Walnut Street train station. Feast of San Sebastiano. Please come out and join us. It's always a lot of fun. Music probably starts around 5 o'clock. And, of course, fun, festivities, rides, and the great food.
Oh, yeah, that's a lot of fun. And give us a date on that.
That is this upcoming Thursday, August 22nd.
Wonderful. Yeah, there are several Italian feasts around the Northeast, and I know St. Rocco and of course San Gennaro and some other ones, and they're always great. They're always a lot of fun and a lot of music. And getting back to music in film, I think that some of the what we call the like the film sequential coordinators, mm-hmm. like the, you know, the film coordinators in the movies, mm-hmm. who will go through, sift through many, many film songs, mm-hmm. old and new, and actually watch footage and listen to 10 different songs behind it to pick the right one, mm-hmm. that one that fits best.
And you know, but you know, I think we talked about this. Quentin Tarantino specifically curates songs for his movies, and they are just so, like, just the music in Pulp Fiction was unbelievable. Of course, in Reservoir Dogs,
sure.
In almost every single movie. But right now in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, just the amount of music that he set, that he must have gone through, just phenomenal. Just a phenomenal amount of songs.
Yeah, it really sets the mood in that 1969 mm. Los Angeles era,
yeah.
Time. And you're right. He does. He's done a lot of other things too, because he's actually made groups famous who were never heard of before. Mm-hmm. If you remember the Japanese group in Kill Bill, the three girls. Were they called? The 5, 6, 7, 8s. There we go. Thank you, Preston. Preston, our engineer and musicologist. I mean, he had actually heard them in a record shop, and he asked the record store or owner, you know, who are these people? And he told him, and he said, well, I have to meet them. I have to find them. So he actually introduced them, and they wound up being in the movie. That's not only the music, but they performed in it, too. Mm-hmm.
That's a distinctive sound.
Yeah. So I do like Quentin Tarantino a lot. I think some people don't, some people do, but I like his movies, and I think he's a very interesting director.
Yeah. I like his taste in music, too. You know, So.
Yeah, there's... there's so many, such an important part, and I've been very fortunate to be able to play in several movie soundtracks myself, and as a studio musician. And you go into a studio, and sometimes you watch film and play, and sometimes you just read sheet music, or they say play something in the key of G, and you just play. But usually, you know, it's written out, And you don't notice till you go back and see the film and you watch it and go, oh, that's what I was doing.
Yeah.
Now I get it. Well, you've been listening to the Johnny Mandolin Show, the fastest hour in radio, because we have too much fun. I want to thank all our listeners for listening. Always tune into City World Radio, also Italian American Radio, where we broadcast all Italian American stuff. That's just fun. I want to thank Eric DeLauro for coming in. Thank you, Eric.
Pleasure. Thank you for having me, John. Please see us on our internet site, SinatraIdol.com or EricDeLauro.com.
Yeah, check out Eric, because he's got a great show and you will like it. And my good friend, Al Carbolosa. Al?
Great to see you, Johnny.
Good to be here with you.
Good
to hang out.
Yeah,
we're just having too much fun. I know. It's illegal in New York now. You need a fun permit now to, you know.
Always.
I want to thank Preston, our engineer. Always tune in, but don't touch that mouse, because right after us, more great radio. We're on 24/7. We're in about 46 countries, and we're growing all the time. I always say we're all over the world, and next week we're expanding. So, all right. Thanks again, folks. Thanks for listening on the Johnny Mandolin Show. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thanks, Preston.